And I think this will be interesting, Joe, because we are coming at this from two. It was because you was posting about, it was your post you put on Threads about you've gone back to the original FF. Correct me if I'm wrong, but it just looked like, because sometimes you scroll through Threads, you read one, forget one. It sounded like you'd been inspired by the casting of the film to go back and read. Or not inspired. Did you say that someone gave that put all
So,
this down?
Marvel put out on April 4th, they decided to make that whatever Fantastic 4 day, right? 4-4, I guess, FF. And they put a page. It was marvel.com/forward/Fantastic Four. And it took you, there's a picture of Herbie, and it said like the typical error page, like 404 not found. And it
Right.
said like, underneath it, there might be something more to this, right? So if you actually click on Herbie, it takes you to this next web page of like, it has Future Foundation, which I tried to look into that. That's kind of very convoluted. And I stopped looking into that more. And then it was like, here are some things to read. I mean, I forget exactly. Let's see. Marvel.com/Fantastic Four. And then click on Herbie. It says, delegates, we're glad you can join us to prepare for the upcoming meeting. You've been granted access to read these issues on Marvel Unlimited. So I think even if you didn't have Marvel Unlimited, you could read these issues for free, would be my
Oh,
guess.
cool. Cool.
So it was Fantastic Four number 1, 48, 49, 50, and then number 1 of Fantastic Four Life Story. So I ended up reading all of those, and then I read the rest of Life Story because there's only 6 issues, and I was intrigued. However, I just had read, I was like looking up what people thought of it. They absolutely hate, I guess like true Fantastic Four fans hate Fantastic Four Life Story.
Wow, I've never read that one.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I don't know. I think part of it is I after reading a lot of comments about it, part of it I think is there was a Spider-Man Life Story that came out and people absolutely love that. And so it wasn't the same. It was almost the same thing, but in Spider-Man, from how I take it, it's supposed to be like a celebration of this character's life, and they interject real life events that are happening in the world into major plot points that Spider-Man has gone through. And they basically age Spider-Man through his life while going over major plot points that people know about and also including like real life events in the story, where it seems like they only took one major plot point, which was Galactus in Fantastic Four. And then they do interject a lot of like other things, but it seems like they take it in a very, not in a celebratory way, but more like a dismal kind of way, I guess, of like Reed not being a very good father or spouse
Oh,
and
wow,
lots of
here
other
we go.
things. Yeah. So a lot of people didn't like it. I look at it as one, I didn't really know, because I haven't read enough Fantastic Four of like what to expect or no. Like I just took that as what it was, like face value. I knew some of this stuff didn't happen in like the original Fantastic Four, like some things happened that I'm like,
I
obviously
mean,
this doesn't happen. So I looked at it as like an alternate kind of universe.
almost like a DC Elseworlds kind
Yeah, like I looked at it as a
of
different universe.
if
And I think
mate.
the biggest thing is like everyone, almost all the comments that I'm reading about it are, one, they're upset that it took more of this like pessimistic view again of like Reed Richards not being all that stuff and some other stuff happened. But a lot of people are comparing it to the Spider-Man one, of like how really good that was, and this is supposed to be like very similar, and people were like, this isn't the same thing. And so I think that's what a lot of people are upset about, but either way,
Wow. So, but you enjoyed it. You in
yeah, I liked it. I thought it was a good and interesting kind of take on things.
And this is what I'm, well, this is what I'm finding interesting, Joe, with your, and we did touch on this on when we done the comic reviews. And I said to you, you are coming from everything. And there's nothing wrong with this, by the way. It's just, I'm a bit envious because you're so bright-eyed and bushy-tailed about, because
Thank you.
everything is new. And don't we all, like, after 50 years collecting comic, reading comics, and I've got a few of the old ones out here to go through
Okay.
with you. And not much. Listen, it's not going to be a moan and a groan about the film, which we haven't seen yet. And apart from the casting of Chalabel, aka Silver Surfer S, I don't mind the casting. The casting, I think, is quite strong. The guy from Stranger Things.
Yeah. Yeah. So Quinn, I think.
He's a great actor. I mean, come on. Pascal. He's a great actor.
He is. He's great.
I know people are moaning. He was the one I wasn't up in arms about. Well, actually, I'm not even up in arms about Chalabel. Julia Garner, is it?
Yeah, I think so.
Really, we'll get into the missed opportunity, I think, because I think I know, and you've read the Galactus, the coming of Galactus, haven't you? The 40 mm-hmm. issues, 48, 49, and 50.
Yep.
Right. But we'll get to that.
Okay, that's fine.
We'll get to that. Why I think I'm not, because back in the day, I used to get really angry. But I think, and my channel did grow in a way off back of a lot of crap.
That was easy.
I mean, the She-Hulk reviews I used to do, I mean, you could see I was so angry at the beginning. But in the end, I just mocked it. It was so shambolic and inept and unprofessional but it's a negative space to go into. And if anyone has followed my channel for any length of time, they will realize that suddenly I stopped.
Yeah.
Suddenly I stopped. And it was because I can't keep doing this. I can't keep being
negative
language, but shit on from a great height by dismal minus.
Yeah.
Because it's all the stuff I love and I've got an investment here.
Right. Yeah.
I've got some old comics here, Joe. So, you know, my first introduction to Fantastic Four, and I haven't even done a bonjour, but I think should we just go for it?
Sure. There's your bonjour right there.
Ground running. So I wouldn't have been picking up the original Fantastic Four comics that I've got in my collection, right? Which I've gone back and collected. But look, 1972, right?
Yeah.
Mighty World of Marvel. That would have been, so I've only been 5 years old. So I wouldn't have, I was probably starting picking this up when I was about six, and I've gone back and collected these ones. But they're black, like, look at the crude colouring.
Yeah.
The Hulk story in it, look, has got green.
Oh my goodness.
It's black and white, but they've added green.
Yeah, green.
5p in 1972. Anyway, so I have got an investment of 50 years in these characters. And it can only be, it does boil down to this disappointment that, and I'm not talking about Fantastic Four now, I'm just talking about in general.
Yeah.
When you have got an investment in characters, and it's not all about money, it's about time. It might be a poster on your wall, might be a character you really loved. That's where Marvel continually go wrong. Continually. But so with the casting of the main Fantastic Four, I've got to say, I can't see anything to moan about. All right, old Pedro might be a bit old, to be fair. He might be. He's looking good for his age, so he can get away with it.
Good. Yeah.
They are actors, they are going to act, because I know that, you know, so I did get into it a bit on, it was either Fred's or on one of my YouTube videos, and someone was saying, oh, well, Reed Richards was only so-and-so age, and I never even realised that, because to me, he's always got the bit of grey. A bit like he's handsome with a little bit of grey, just like me.
Yeah.
Oh, you're too young, Joe. You actually, you're looking better than me with a little bit of grey.
No.
But anyway, yeah, I've lost my train of thought now, thinking about how pretty...
Oh, Pedro Pascal was too old.
The casting. Vanessa Kirby, spot on. But as long as they've got the chemistry...
Right.
I just my pure personal opinion. They're not quite a dysfunctional family.
No.
But not quite. But they need to be a family. So right. I think Pedro can be... And I did say, when they originally announced that it was going to be a female Silver Surfer, I did a video, and I said in that you know, cast a black actor as Ben Grimm. If you've got boxes to tick, I mean, I'm trying to balance things out. If you've got boxes to tick, and I'm sure there's going to be plenty of black actors in it, I'm sure there's going to be plenty of everything, because we all know that Marvel have got their boxes to tick. But they haven't. But that's good casting as well. So they have gone, oh my God, and now they've got I know I'm kind of flopping onto the race bit here, but they could have gone, and this will be, bear with me, because this could be in Disney's defense here. They could have gone, because the only ones that need to be the same race, really, and they don't even have to do that, is Sue and Johnny, because they're brother and sister. But they could have had, they could be siblings from different mums and dads, and oh my God, we could have, and we need half hour to explain that in the film, but they haven't. I think they've gone pretty straight. So, I'm gonna say I'm cautiously optimistic until we start talking about Chalabel. But before I do, I want to hear your thoughts on the film and the announcements, and your expectations, Joe. Like from that brand new perspective. Like, you love the MCU is what brought you into the comics. So,
yeah, I mean, from my perspective, the casting seems fine. Like, I like Joseph Quinn for Johnny Storm. I like him as an actor. I thought he did great in Stranger Things. I don't know if I've ever watched anything that Vanessa Kirby was in, but she seems like she fits the bill for a Sue Storm, right? Just looking at her from...
Was she not the bad girl in Mission Impossible?
She might have been. I don't know. I haven't seen... the last Mission Impossible I watched was probably maybe Mission Impossible 2 or 3, like...
Right, yeah.
A long time ago. What else? I don't mind Pedro Pascal. I like him as an actor. Like, I've liked him in The Mandalorian. I can see why people are like, he's a little old. Like, I get that perspective. But Reed Richards too, from the little bit that I know from just the comics, he looks older, right? He's got that little Silver Fox-esque stripe going on, right? That we already talked about. And I think from more of a perspective on my end, it makes me a little worried, because I think he's, I don't know how old he is. I mean, he looks great for his age, but we're probably talking, you know, a commitment to being Reed Richards in the MCU. We're looking at probably, you know, a good 8 to 10 year commitment, if not longer, would be my guess, right? Mm-hmm. He's just going to keep getting older. And I think the biggest concern for a lot of folks was just like how busy he is. Like, he's definitely at the top of his like acting career right now, right? And he's in a lot of stuff. So, like, how spread thin is he going to be and all of those kinds of things, which I get, right? And but I have full faith in Pedro Pascal and, you know, what he can do. I think he'll be great. Ebon Moss, I forget the rest of his name, as the Thing. Apparently, he's a great actor. I haven't watched The Bear. This is a completely off topic, but, like, I've watched the first 2 episodes of it. People love the heck out of this show. I don't like it at all. I don't think it's that great. Just doesn't fit my...
No, I haven't tried it. And I think that was a bit... I think The Bear was getting forced on us all because it won some awards. I think everyone was going, oh my God, you need to see it. And I thought,
I watched. I watched the first episode before all the awards happened, right? It was still doing well. People were talking about it. And then it won all those awards recently. And I was like, all right, let's revisit it again. Watch the first episode again. Watch the second one. I'm like, this isn't for me. I'm not going to dedicate more time to it. It's just, I don't get what people like. It is what it is. To each their own. obviously he's Jewish from my understanding, and obviously Ben Grimm is Jewish.
Yeah, that's spot on.
That's a big thing. And then obviously we have a female Silver Surfer who is a completely different character, but is comic, quote unquote, I guess, accurate, right? She's supposed to, you know, I don't know 100%. You can correct me. But it's a female. It's Silver Surfer's love interest or something along those lines.
It's tenuous. It's very, very tenuous. Okay. Shalabal.
This is what I don't know. And this is me, and this is my perspective. I could care less on what they do for those characters in terms of being quote unquote comic accurate. Like, right. I don't care. They made Reed Richards black, yellow, whatever. Like, I don't care. Like,
would have been very annoying.
Just do what you think is best and who's going to carry the movie well, right? Like,
yeah.
To me, I don't care. You can make I don't care. Like, it doesn't matter to me. Because, again, I can understand the adaptation part from comics to a movie and how there needs to be some continuity. But I think sometimes people really want it to be like, needs to be just like this. And I get from, like, your perspective, right? Like, you grew up with these characters. You have a certain expectation of what you're going to see on screen. Yeah. Whereas also from my perspective, someone who's relatively new to this, hasn't really been into the comics as long as you have. And even if I was, I still don't have the same amount of history as you. My perspective is just different, right? Like, I just don't have that expectation of what to see because I'm still relatively new to all this. I also think, again, it's just me and I just don't care. Like, as long as I'm seeing a good movie, I'm cool with it.
Yeah. And which is good. And I think I'm with you, Joe, as far as that goes. And it's that word adaption. And like I said earlier, it's, you've got an investment as a fan. You've got an investment, right? But as a fan, and the millions of fans that have either grown up with Fantastic Four or know the Fantastic Four through the comics, the cartoons, the previous two couple of films, whatever it is, you are kind of familiar with these characters. And I do get that there needs to be a new approach. It needs to be fresh for the modern age and et cetera, et cetera. And it didn't quite work with the first couple of films, did it? Which I've rewatched recently, and I think they were all right.
Here's a full disclosure. I've never even seen any of the Fantastic Four films.
Oh, wow. Well, treat yourself. They make the last 2 years of MCU output. Well, the Fantastic Four films look like they deserve an Oscar. You will realize how bad it's been. But they weren't held in very high regard. I mean, I can remember
most people, from my understanding, don't really care for them, and a lot of people seem like,
but when you rewatch,
they didn't do a really good job of them. And again, I don't know because I didn't see them, so I can't really. I'm not going to give my opinion.
Oh, but Joe, when you rewatch them, you think, "Oh, this weren't that bad compared to what we've got recently." Marvel content, you think, "Oh, wow, they should have got an Oscar for this. There should have been awards. There should have." But that's not very fair because the latest output hasn't been the bestest ever.
No. So, although I have liked a lot of stuff as of late, but they did rush a lot of things as well. They were just like putting out a lot. And now, anyway, we're digressing.
Yeah, that's all right. You know,
that's your bit.
That's my thing. Yeah. Yeah. I'll go right off the rails. It's what I think they're going to do is the same old that hasn't worked in the past few years, which is they are going to have Shalabal team up with Invisible Woman to save the day. Let's see how good a prediction that is.
Those comics that they recommended you read, it kind of seems like that's the storyline they're taking.
Silver Surfer saved the day.
Right.
And the fact that Chalabel appeared in has appeared in let's say a handful of comics in the past 60 years that Fantastic Four has been going, you can see what a cynical move it is to include her rather than the original Silver Surfer that made the original comics sing so gloriously because of him being male and Alicia Masters. It was Alicia Masters that gets Silver Surfer on side, which is Ben Grimm's, for anyone that doesn't know, Ben Grimm's blind girlfriend, which is a totally other story, which is also glorious. They are missing the whole dynamic of the fact that Ben Grimm don't like it. That it's the one, so she saves humanity by getting the Silver Surfer realizes, oh my God, this is what I've been doing. You know, they could go down the you remind me of someone route. And that someone would be Chalabel, which was his wife back on his planet. You know, Chalabel kind of came from an alternate reality, another Earth 671-2482, wherever it was. And so, yes, it's comic accurate. But is it really? I think they've really, really grasped for a very, very delicate straw there. And sure. Instead of leaning into,
yeah, well, Silver Surfer,
what made, you know, is he in his own title in the late 60s, it didn't run for very long, but obviously he was a big part of Fantastic Four. Then he had a massive run in the 80s and the 90s, 100-odd issues. And obviously he's a beloved character. But no, yeah. We won't do that. I just see it. I don't know. I hope I'm wrong. I hope I'm wrong, but nevertheless, for my side of the fandom, you're sure. Going to be watching the film, and I still hope it can still be a great movie. I'm not gonna say it's gonna be crap, until they release it and we realise it is, because it is also directed by the guy who did WandaVision.
Okay,
and I know people like that as well. It was a bold gamble.
It was.
It was a bold gamble. Yeah.
I mean, I liked WandaVision. I'll tell you what, though. When it first came out, that was like the first Disney Plus show, right? And as I'm watching, literally the first two episodes, I had no idea what was happening. I was like, what are we watching?
Yeah.
Like, we're clearly going through decades of different television kind of like styles. Yeah. But I'm like, what is happening right now? Like, what are we watching? What is happening? I had no clue. You may not be wrong with what they're going to do with Chalabel. I think, again, I don't have any perspective on this. The little bit that I know of Silver Surfer is from those comics that I just read. And like you said, he's the one who saved the day, essentially, after realizing he has consciousness, or he has become conscious, or of his conscience. From Alicia, right?
She kind of wakes him up.
That these people have something that we have something to offer as humans. And you were right, Ben Grimm hates it. He's like, who the heck is this guy? And he's like super jealous, which was like, I thought that was kind of weird, but I get it. Like, it just kind of like went into this whole Ben Grimm is so depressed.
He's just like, hey, or you've been talking to my girlfriend, but
yep.
enjoyable.
Yeah, I think, again, I think it could be a good movie. From my understanding and perspective, though, it seems like obviously Dr. Doom is the like ultimate archenemy for the Fantastic Four, and like that is looming in the background with what we know is potentially going to happen, right? I've seen some other people kind of complain about, not complain, but like bring up thoughts, I guess, on Galactus being, I guess, the main villain in this movie, which makes sense, but like he seems like a very big threat to use right away. And then Now, who knows, right? I mean, Marvel could not kill him per se, or just leave him in the background. I don't know. I feel like that's one thing that Marvel does not so great. It's like they just kill people off.
Yeah.
And now you're never expected to see them again.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, my perspective, and I don't think we'll see Dr. Doom, and if we do in this movie, it's going to be like in the end scene credits, or it's just going to be like a, I don't know, like a silhouette. That would be my guess, right? Of like what's looming in the background. But like in my perspective, even as we get further into the MCU and they do Secret Wars and all this other stuff, you cannot kill, like they killed Thanos, right? Like you cannot kill Dr. Doom. I just feel like you can't do that. Now, I'm a Dr. Doom fan, so I'm slightly biased, but I feel like he should always just be looming. Like you can defeat him and win, but he should never die. Like he should always be a threat. And there's lots of stories where he teams up with Avengers and other people to fight, you know, for a greater good for himself, to fight another enemy, right? I would like to see, I think that would be cool to see. Like we really don't see that very much in terms of like an anti-hero. The only one that I can think of is Loki, who's been made basically into a hero. In Marvel, essentially.
God, I don't know what they've done to him, to be fair. Not my Loki, like he's just a fop, you know, just a foil for female Loki to be powerful woman.
I just think that if you're gonna have Galactus as your main enemy or your main villain, I mean, go for it. I mean, he doesn't really,
like, it's too big.
Yeah, it's almost like too big, right, to go right away. Because I would assume that they're going to have more than one Fantastic Four film, right? Now, there's talks that this may not even be in the MCU. There's rumors that this isn't in the MCU universe. It's going to be in a different.
Oh, I'd love that. I'd love it.
Which is interesting because, like, when you think about it, we've had all of this stuff happen in the MCU. And there hasn't ever been a mention of the Fantastic Four, right? It's like,
no.
How are you going to intervene and interweave all of this happenings around? And I know it can be done. Obviously, you can't do it posthumously to all the stuff that's already happened. But like, I mean, where were they, right? Like when you go back and think about it, like to all the stuff that's happened, it's like, well, where was the Fantastic Four?
Yeah.
They were just sleeping. I don't know. Out in space.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it. Yeah, yeah. But I love the fact that there is talk of that, and I don't think they're going to be brave enough to do that. To be fair,
I don't think so either.
And the whole Galactus thing, the Thanos thing, I don't think anyone planned that when they done the first Iron Man film. I don't think.
I mean, of course not. Not even close. Not even close.
I think there was something organic to an element of luck, for one.
There was. It honestly was. I mean, they even said that they were just throwing spaghetti at a wall to see what stuck.
Because the Captain America, the first Avenger film, that didn't go down as good, nor did the first two Thor films. They didn't.
No, none of them did. I honestly, those movies, when I was watching, like I told you, I didn't really get into this until I watched Black Panther. And I just thought it was completely different than almost any other superhero movie that I watched. And I don't know what it was that drew me in, but because it was so different, like Iron Man, I think the Iron Man movies are boring. All of them. I think they're all.
No, oh, yeah. I enjoyed the first one. I thought the first one was cool.
It was cool looking back and what it actually accomplished is really cool, right? Yeah. As I'm watching it, I'm like, okay, cool. I didn't mind the first Captain America. The Thors were okay. I liked Ragnarok. But I think it's because it had like a great soundtrack and, you know, good quips to it. But I mean, even just like the first Avengers film, I was like, this is boring. Like, I don't think this is exciting.
I didn't expect this. I expected better from you, Joe.
When I first watched them, as someone who still wasn't like fully enveloped into the world, I was like, "Eh, these are okay."
None of them were the best of the genre, or of, yeah, just they weren't the best fun times. But as a, maybe we're all guilty of looking back on them all in totality rather than just, you know, as a film per se. But what you're saying about Galactus, I'd love to see them just have a villain, an antagonist arrive, and they defeat him in one film, in 2 hours, under 2 hours. Come on, get on with it.
That wouldn't be bad either. Instead of drawing it out for films and films and films.
For another trilogy.
Yeah. I mean, we don't necessarily need another trilogy. I wouldn't mind. I'm assuming there are going to be more Fantastic Four films, but I would like it to be clearly interwoven into hopefully what their plan is with Secret Wars, which would make the most sense, obviously.
And with Doctor Doom, if they want to do the trilogy, we know that the people at the top with the money are going to say we want a trilogy because we've got the paperwork here that tells us that a trilogy is what we have to do. So you've got to do an FF trilogy. Introduce Doctor Doom in the first film, helping Fantastic Four. He's not Doom yet.
Yep.
At the end, he falls out with Reed. And this has all been done in the comics. Yeah. And right. I'm not going through anything. All the people involved have to do is do what you've done, Joe, and read a few comics.
Yeah.
The source material.
Yeah.
It's like if you was going to get involved in a book adaptation, you would assume, you know, say it was a book series, but you was only adapting the first book. You would like to think that if there were six books in the series, all the people involved would be just getting into the books.
Right.
It would be required reading. I wouldn't expect anyone to do 60 years of FF.
No.
My God.
I think doing some of this is good. I think the biggest problem is, and we had this talk in a quick text, is that this website that was out, most people don't even know it exists. Only to, from what I'm assuming, are like the big fans of Marvel and what's going on, especially ones who are into comics. Now you get a person who's interested in the MCU or just the movies and really not into comics. They might see this and go, yeah, I'm not reading comics, whether it's because they don't like them, they're just not a big reader, whatever it is, right? But generally speaking, I would say the broad audience, which is what most of these movies bring in, you know, they don't know that this website page exists.
No.
They're not even going to know that, quote unquote, this is the recommended reading to do, right? While any good movie will hash out all of the details anyway, that would not even require you to read these things. It's just like extra, again, background info for you, which just kind of like completes the story maybe a little bit more.
Yeah.
I think it would be great for more people to do that. Well, I don't think it's required, but again, I think the biggest miss is that the marketing is not there for people to like make that connection to read some of these kind of just like basic comics of like what's happening.
And that actually, you've touched on something there, Joe, which I'm just thinking with my business head on.
Yep.
And you want people to read more comics based on the films. Because when I had shops, that was when the first Iron Man film came out and, you know, things were kicking off. And do you know what? You were screaming, and I couldn't have been the only comic shop in the world, screaming for more content attached to the films that were coming out. Because she was. Apart from doing a photo cover on an Iron Man comic, I remember they'd done, you know.
Yeah.
Action figures, all right. But there was no...
Yeah, I think... That's like,
if you like the film, come on in. So...
Right.
You
would think, and we talked about this too, right? I think it's two separate things, right? There's like Marvel, there's the movie side, and then there's the comic print side.
Yeah.
And while the people at the top talk about like what to adapt and take, blah, 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 from each side, the people in the movie side don't care about what happens over here because this is like small peanuts compared to what this is bringing in. However, the people on the comic side would really love that piggyback off of the movie side, right? Because that would just mean more business, right? And I think from a Marvel, top of Marvel perspective, right? In quote unquote, again, I've only been in comics for like a year. From my understanding, comics, quote unquote, is are dying. I don't know how true or not true that is.
No,
I don't have access to numbers.
Yeah.
I can see why it is, right? Just like the age of digital stuff, right? But like, you would think from a big Marvel perspective that they would try harder to push people to print stuff just to make more money.
Or to the digital, even if so.
Yeah, or to digital.
All of the Silver Surfer comics that they've ever printed in omnibus edition, when the films come out, if it's the real Silver Surfer, and I will call him the real Silver Surfer, you can now sell, hopefully, you do a good job, you can sell all of those collected editions, whether they're in black and white, like the big essential Marvel editions, you know, thick, or whether you can do just specific albums of stuff. But potentially now you've got content that's already there. You just have to pay a few royalties. Well, I don't think they'll have to do that, because I think it would be a pay and play contract that all these creators did back in the day.
Probably.
For Surfer,
Yeah.
Fantastic Four comics, you know, blah, blah,
Yep.
You know, ad infinitum. So on a very, very, very basic level, if I'm gonna cast aspersions on the casting of a female Silver Surfer, on a purely business front, you've missed a trick, because you've got, I don't know how many appearances of that actual character in Silver Surfer form you've got. It is not many.
Yeah, from a business perspective.
And I think at the very best, it was some kind of in a multiverse scenario. The other thing as well is that many, many top-notch comic creators have had a shot at the Fantastic Four. And this is the other thing about they're bringing something new and fresh with the movie, which I'm skeptical about. I'm not going to crap on it yet. Overall, with the casting of the main group, I'm happy. Not sure about the director. I'm not sure about, but anyway, it can all come together. They could make it work, but I've been hurt too much. I've been hurt too much by Disney in recent years. So look at some of the, I've got some props, Joe. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Let's show them.
Because you enjoy, and so do I, by the way, the recent Ultimate line.
Mm-hmm.
So back in the day, I don't know if you ever have you've heard of the original Ultimate line that they did.
I have heard of that, yeah.
Right, Ultimate FF.
Okay. Oh wow,
now,
I didn't know that was the Ultimate.
Brian okay. Michael Bendis.
Oh well, he's always good.
And Mark Millar, or Millar. How do you pronounce that Millar with the A?
I would say Millar, yeah.
Would you? In a Millar. Yeah, because you're American Millar. There's a comedian in the UK that says, or as the Americans say, and whatever word it was, he'd go, I can't think of a word now. They would go, yeah, and Millar. Anyway, Bendis Millar. I can't say that now without, I can't say that with a British accent. How weird is that? Millar. Oh, that sounded British, didn't it? Millar.
A little bit, yeah.
Millar.
There you go.
Anyway, Bendis and Millar. And the Ultimate, like,
your
right.
Bendis is always good.
So, that. And I wanted to show this cover because it's got Crystal from the Inhumans as only Greg Land can. But look at how they're still trying to reinvent. And I don't know what year this was. These were nine. No, these weren't the 90s. These were the 2000s. Yeah, 2005. So before that, the hot shot, the shit hot creators of the time.
Yep.
Look at that. Jim Lee.
Okay.
Brandon Choice, Scott Williams. Red hot off the press of Image. Making a name for themselves, and Marvel just threw money at them.
Yeah.
Just threw money at them. I will get to my point. I've got one more prop to show you. And then there's Grant Morrison and Jay Lee. And okay. This was something special. This was Ben Grimm getting his wish, which is basically to be human again.
Oh, all right.
And I really enjoyed it with Yancey Street and all the rest of it. Ben Grimm get, as only Grant Morrison can do. But no one, my point to all that, Joe, is that no one is holding any of these versions of the Fantastic Four in high regard all these years later, whether it's the 1990s, the 2000s, or in the middle. No one. What, when you say Fantastic Four to people, they'll either say, oh, what, them two shit films, or they will know the comics, that the originals.
Right.
I believe. Or maybe the morning cartoons.
Yeah. I mean, I only know a little bit, and I have only read a handful of Fantastic Four. Like, I've read those four, those original ones, 1, 48, 49, 50. And then I read the life story, all 1 through 6. And then I've actually been reading the current Fantastic Four run.
What do you think of that, John?
I like it. I've only made it through like the first 4 or 5 issues.
This one.
I noticed that cover.
I had to get that. That was a J. Scott Campbell cover.
Okay.
All the rest of them are they're all Alex Ross covers.
Yeah, all Alex Ross covers. Yeah.
Beautiful. Yeah.
I mean they're incredible. Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Beautiful. I thought it was interesting. I like the it's almost like how there's like different perspectives on each of like the first 4 issues, right? Because there's one just like Ben. The first one's Ben and Alicia, and then it's Johnny.
Yep.
And then it's Sue and Reed, and then it's them all coming together right after something bad happened.
Yeah.
Which I thought was interesting. Like, I liked how that was going. What I have found interesting, because I haven't really seen this yet, and I think this goes back to like more classic comics, I think, is that like, almost every, obviously there's an overarching story that we've only touched on a little bit so far, at least that's what I've read. But each issue, I want to keep saying episode, each issue is, what I want to say, just like a self-contained story. It's like, we're going to deal with what's happening right now, and now it's over. There's like literally no carryover, almost literally no carryover from issue to issue. Whereas almost everything that I have read, especially more nowadays, it's like there's one big issue. We might get some smaller ones added in, but it's just this big thing from issue to issue. It just keeps getting carried over and carried over until it gets resolved, essentially.
Yeah.
So I thought that was interesting. I don't know if I like it. And I might be conditioned to like what's happening more so now than
you're conditioned.
Anything.
I like that. You're conditioned. Yeah. And I think, I mean, I say that a lot in my weekly comic reviews, which is obviously all the new stuff. I can't help but say, if I like a comic, if you're not picking up the floppies every month or reading it digital, what do you watch it digitally or you read it anyway?
Yeah,
I recommend the trade paperback. Finding is that is the modern format, and I think, you know, from an editorial perspective, I think everything is 6 and 8. Oh, what was that? What was the FF one you had?
It's a volume 1 of the Hickman run.
Yes,
nice. I haven't even I cracked it open, but I haven't read anything yet. I'm still working my way through the Avengers. There it is.
That's sorry. It. Your one's bigger than mine, Joe.
It is. Just a little bit.
How comes you got? Oh, I've only got that one. No, I've got the rest anyway. I can't believe the sheer luck that I got.
Yeah,
that
right.
Out of an entire long box of comic. I can't put it back. I'm going to have to flop it on the top now.
But I do like as you're going through, like I like getting the floppies, but I also like, I really prefer the trade paperback. One, it's just a lot easier to just like, here's the whole book, go through it, whatever.
Yeah, definitely. I do see the appeal. And what you said about the recent Fantastic Four, I did enjoy that element of it for the first, I think it was four issues you said. I think it was
Yeah,
four.
I've read like the first four or five, I think.
But it's the Fantastic Four, and I was longing for them to just get back together and get on with it. And I've got to admit, I don't know what issue I bailed out on, actually. I've done the first 10.
Okay. I think
And
they're on 14, 12, something like that.
I think, I don't think it was long ago that I bailed out, and I just thought, oh, do you know what? 10 is a right, nice, neat round number. But I just felt like, oh, they are really like, come on, Ryan North, who's doing it? Oh, get on with it now, mate. Please get on with it
I
now.
mean, from those were, those might have been the first Fantastic Four issues that I read,
No,
honestly.
and that's not a bad like you say.
Oh, a lot of people said that they've liked it and they really liked it. So I was like, oh, let's hop on now that we're not too far on and I can get a good amount on Marvel Unlimited. So I was reading through and to me it was interesting. I'm like, all right, they're obviously separated. Something happened. And it was just kind of long though. It's like each one has their own thing. And I'm like, all right, when are we? Are we going to get back together? What's happening? What was so bad that they're all in different places and not together?
In a way, like you've got 10, well, I've got 10 issues in, which is nearly a year.
I think that to
You've got to
me,
think
that's the
about.
most annoying. And I don't know. You can tell me if this is like very classic Reed Richards. It seems to be just a little overdone in these issues. This current run of Fantastic Four is like, obviously, Reed Richards is uber smart, but like he starts to explain stuff in a very scientific way. And a classic thing is like, all right, explain it to us. It's always been Ben or Johnny. And it's like, okay, explain it to me like a normal person, basically. And I get that. I feel like it's just overdone. It's just like a joke that's been said too many times.
Right.
And I'm like, Reed Richards doesn't always need to be this like scientific drawn out kind of thing.
Nerdy.
Like I get that that's how he is, and I didn't know, just with those being my first ones, if that's how he was depicted in kind of classic comics or other kind of runs. And from the little that I've read so far and other things, it's not, and I could be wrong, but because I still have only read like a handful, but he doesn't always like go on and on in such scientific language.
No, I think that was Ryan North showing off how much research
Okay.
he's done, to be fair.
Okay. Because I'm like, this is, I
That's
get
good.
it. Like, I
I'm a
get
good
it. I
story, I think.
appreciate it, but it's a little too much. Like, one time is fine.
He was, I think he was going a bit Hickman. I thought we might have had a chart or two in the back of the in the back of each comic, or a map, or I don't know, a glossary of scientific terms.
Oh my gosh.
But I think, why I've got a few props out, Joe,
Yeah.
and showing a few of the comics is I think what that shows is how difficult it is to tell a great Fantastic Four story. I think with Spider-Man, with the others of that era, actually, I think Thor is in this category, and it would take an entire other video for me to explain what's going on in my head now. But Spider-Man is such a class, is such a spot on the, you know, you've got your Superman and Batman on the other side of the road. I'm trying to think of some other Marvel ones. Maybe Captain America's pretty straight. I mean, Iron Man was pretty straight. But with a Fantastic Four, you've got, I think you've got a lot going on there, and I think you've got a lot to deal with. And I think the simpler you keep it, the better it's going to be. If you have Doctor Doom, if you do a flashback with him, or if you do not a flashback, if you do opening credits with Reed at some highfalutin uni with Doctor, I'm forgetting his name now. What's Doctor Doom's?
Victor Von Doom.
Yeah, with Victor, and they're both together and they're competitive and all the rest of it. A bit like the Xavier Magneto dynamic in the X-Men films, which worked so well. It worked really well, where you can understand why Magneto is
That's it
how
right there.
he is. And I know they kind of they had to keep going up and up, had to
Yeah.
ramp it up. But in those earlier films,
that did though. That's what it. Yeah, keep going.
Yeah, and I think in the first film, in the first FF film, and if we're just spitballing, if they introduce Victor, and he in conjunction with Reed, and all right, Shalabel saves the Earth. Oh, if they're going to run with it, let them run with it. But that could be a way of, all right, Galactus is defeated within 2 hours. I love it. I love that. Right, yeah. Go yeah. away now.
Yeah, do it, yeah.
But in number two, it's going to be Victor.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be Victor. There's going to be something about what happened. And they could build up that in film, you know, if they're going to do yeah. the three films intelligently.
Right.
But having read the glossary of content that we have and pick the best, and I still maintain to this day, Joe, that the best example of adapting a comic character is the Netflix Daredevil show, where they got the best, they didn't just get one graphic novel or 1 year of comics. They mashed up so much. Daredevil's one of my, as you know, is one of my favorite, he's my top two. Daredevil and Captain America, my top two. So I know how much those guys and girls mixed in. And I loved it. They took the best, because it isn't every comic that works.
No. No. And I think that's what people are missing, right? Like, I think that some of these directors will read some of these things, or they'll pick up where they're pulling from or adapting from, and maybe that's it, right? And that's kind of maybe where it falls short a little bit. In terms of like the writing and what to adapt, what not to adapt, whatever you want to say, right? It's like that these characters have been around for years. Yes. And like you said, not every comic, not every issue is a great one.
No.
Even multiple in a row, maybe a whole run is not very good.
No,
right?
No.
It's just how it goes, right?
Like those Fantastic Four comics I just showed you. Actually, I mean, you look at the number on that Hickman run.
Mm-hmm.
That was before they done Legacy. Issue 570, right?
Yeah.
Whereas all those other series, I showed you issue ones and twos, like Ultimate Fantastic Four. I mean, I don't know how long that run for. I don't know if I've got the whole run of that. But I've got up to issue 25. Oh, actually, look at that cover. Look, Sue Storm and Namor.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow, look. It always used to be Sue getting involved with, like, oh no, actually I've got issue six, but that's, yeah, and Mark Millar is still on it.
There you go.
But these great writers, I don't think if you talk to comic book aficionados, they're going to say, oh, that Mark Millar run on Ultimate Fantastic Four was the best I've ever read.
Yeah,
I will go back to it. It is the Stan Lee.
Yeah.
I'm old. It's the Stan Lee, Jack. I'm not saying nothing else can be done, because Ryan Moore has done something a bit new and fresh.
Yep.
May not be for me. And I'm not saying like, oh, that's so crap, but so boring. I've got the first 10 issues and I'm going to spend my money elsewhere.
Yeah.
But it's that Lee Kirby stuff. If they mine... I think you don't mind that.
Yeah. I mean, when you go back and look at some of that, I mean, it is very simple. Like, obviously you can modernize it. Hold on. I'll be right back. I have a prop to get of this.
God, I love props. You know I do.
As a big Dr. Doom fan, Fantastic Four is in my life. Pretty much inevitably. And I mean, as we look.
Oh, nice. I've never seen that before.
I had to do some scouring to find this bad boy. Some serious scouring.
Oh, show me.
It's a.
The Book of Doom. I love it.
Anyway. I mean, classic. Oh, goodness.
Is that the first appearance of Doom?
It is. This one is. And it's like he takes over the Baxter building and he puts a big net over it. Like, talk about like super weird and kind of like silly
it's
things,
hokey.
Right? But
it's
like,
hokey now, isn't it?
It's very hokey. Man. But like, keep it simple. It doesn't have to be crazy. But I, to go back to your point of like having introducing Victor like in this movie as like a helper, because I feel like almost, again, if we take the perspective of what I talked about earlier, like we can't get rid of Dr. Doom. Like, I feel like he should always just be looming in the background, even if he's like not a character for years in the MCU, right? But like, he could be brought back. In fact, again, I think it would be really interesting to have him as Dr. Doom team up with whomever to go up against a greater enemy, whoever that might be at the time, right? Because that has happened. But like, we have to, I feel like Thanos, not many people could like empathize really with Thanos, like in the MCU, right? Like, he's just brought on as this big bad and he like wants to wipe out half the
I thought he had a point.
No, I agree and I get it, right? Like, some of the things, like those cups and shirts of like Thanos was right. but like, he wasn't really made empathetic. Like, you couldn't really feel for him. He was just like, whatever, right? I feel like to make people care more about Dr. Doom and to like empathize and almost be like, wow, I actually feel like he's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Bring him in, like you said, as like still early on where he's competitive with Reed in university, and then have him actually help defeat Galactus. And then in the following films, you know, we see whatever happens with Dr. Doom and between Reed, where they start to have more animosity and get separated, and he now becomes Dr. Doom.
Or at the end of the first film,
it's Reed,
the FF, that get all the praise, and Victor's there, and Reed wants to get his mate Victor some, you know, they're on TV or whatever it is, and, you know, they're having a big parade, and he's going, whoa, and he's really trying hard. Oh, come on, Victor helped us as well, blah, blah, blah. But he's there with his arms folded, going, nah, mate, yeah, go on, you do it.
I don't know. This is just me being a big Dr. Doom fan, but like, I think Dr. Doom, I mean, quote unquote, needs to be done right, could be made a million different ways. But like, after reading a fair amount of Dr. Doom stuff, I haven't read a ton, but like, I almost feel like having a movie just for him, of like to go into his origin, not even in the FF stuff, but like doing, I think even just like a short special feature, like they were doing on like Werewolf by Night. But hold on. I think,
what though, Joe?
I truly think, say that again.
Have you got a Dismal Minus subscription?
I do.
Right. You need to watch, I'm assuming those, they might not be because they're not dismal, are they? They were Sony, weren't they? Or whatever it was. 20th Century Fox, I think. The first two FF films.
Yeah, I think they're on there. They're on there, yeah.
Boom is either in one.
Yeah.
Certainly in one, if not both of them.
Yeah.
And the Silver Surfer. And the guy who did the Surfer, it was done right. I'm not saying the films were the bestest ever. Yeah. But if you're a Doom fan, it's a must see.
Yeah. No, it is a plan. There's
I'm curious to see, as a mega Doom fan, you are curious to see if you think they've done it right.
Okay, I'll have to look. I think though, a great origin like film movie that they could do in like an hour 15, well, would be Triumph and Torment, Doctor Strange and Doctor Doom. That whole story, I think that would be an amazing special presentation, whatever the heck you want to call it. I think that would do well.
Because that's an element of Doctor Doom that you don't often have explored, which is that the occult side of things.
Right.
No one dips their toe into that. That's a good shout, actually. They won't do it. And it's a good shout. You know, you can join all the rest of us comic fans asking for our favorite stuff, Joe.
I know.
You're saying you've only done it for a year, but you will be as cynical and grizzled as me within enough.
I'm sure I will be.
I'll give you 12 more months.
I'm sure I will be. I mean, I'm always.
You'll still be loving it. You'll
I
still
will. I will still be loving what, you know, Marvel comes out with in terms of like films and shows. I generally like most of it. There are definitely some ones that are way better than others. That's for sure. Like,
definitely. And the only thing for me with that, Joe, as well, is we can't be too,
no,
just because it's, you know, we can't love everything. Like, there are certain people about that just seem to love everything unconditionally.
Yeah, I mean, you can't be like that. You got to have some
unless it's a
negative
pet or a child, it can't be unconditional love, right?
No, I mean, there's got to be some, even if I don't like to use, I don't like being negative about things, but constructive criticism is always
Yes.
appreciated, right?
Yes.
Like,
My constructive criticism for Dismal Minus is stop being shit.
And I have the opposite side. I have liked most of the stuff that they put out. And I think part of that, again, it goes back to my little knowing of the comic background and what to expect. And I think
There's
that's
no
my
pain.
perspective.
You're free of the pain of history, like bearing
Yeah.
down. No, not only, no, to be fair.
But I will say my least favorite thing that they've put out is Secret Invasion. Like that was not like,
shocking, wasn't it? It was so shocking.
I know what to say. I think that like they started to do really well with like the spy thriller kind of aspect to it on certain points, but again, to a certain degree, I'm like, what? This is what it amounted to, and now we have an amalgamation of a character who we'll probably never even see again.
I reviewed that show I think I need to call it, I think I need to do a playlist of the dark days of the hog. Because you only know me
Yeah.
as the happy guy from Threads who loves comics. You only know me as that.
I do. I have not watched any of the Dark Day videos.
There's a dark history there, Joe. Well, actually, that would be me saying that I disagree with what I said. No, I maintain everything I said about She-Hulk. Willow was the other one. I know that's not Marvel, and I know I'm drifting a bit. But She-Hulk, Willow, oh, Secret Invasion, oh, anything else you care to name, I started reviewing it. Some of it I just couldn't get through.
Yeah. Secret Invasion I watched because again I'm like watching all this stuff and to know what's happening, right? Like to be treated as a Marvel fan for further future projects, right? But like Secret Invasion just didn't make sense to me.
And then when you've read the comics like years ago,
Sure,
and
it's
you've
probably
just got that thing in the back of your head where you think, when I say Secret Invasion, you think, God, that was awesome.
right.
And then you see what they're doing and you think, what?
Yeah.
No,
I think
don't.
that, I think again, that was a rushed film. It was a rushed, not film, but series. It was a rushed thing. They had all this money and they're like, go for it. Do whatever you want.
But I couldn't see it on the screen, Joe. Could you? What I did love was the fact that in some of the opening scenes that were supposed to be in Russia, there was a little bit of, I think they sprinkled some like cotton wool in the air. And they had people in furry hats. And it was obviously just somewhere a bit chilly in America. It wasn't even like somewhere in Canada that's really snowy and cold. They was just wandering around a town square. They put a few extras in woolly hats and furry coats. And straight away, I'm looking at
I
it.
will. I will. I'm not going to defend Americans here who are making these more than likely. But this goes to my American ignorance of honestly the rest of the world that it's, I don't know much, right? I only have most of what I've seen in Russia of like in movies, and it's not that, right? But it's like, yeah, throw some coats and some of those furry hats on some people, and you've got Russia covered, right? Like.
That's it.
You've covered most of the American population as disguising whatever you're in as Russia. Congratulations.
You can imagine the director saying, yes, that looks like Russia, everyone. That looks like Russia. And action.
That I think they're just playing up to American
Can they still
ignorance.
smoke cigarettes in Russia?
That is, they're just playing to American ignorance, I think, right there.
Maybe.
I'll even fall
Oh,
for
it's
that.
controversial. I'm going to clip that, Joe.
There you go.
Clip that. They're
I
going
can
to.
say it because I'm American
You
and I'm American.
no, you can't. YouTube is going to. They're going to disown you. They're going
Oh, they
to
probably will. They probably will. Knowing YouTube.
ban. So I think. So what are we saying? I mean, I'm in my. To sum up, that's been a really good discussion, to be fair, Joe, because we are. I love the fact we're coming at it from
Yeah.
so, you're so brand new to it all. And I love that because we all that kind of excitement for everything new
Yeah.
is the exact opposite from mine. But so, I think somewhere in the middle, I think we're both looking forward to it. I mean, I'm going to say I am tentatively. Very delicately looking forward to it. But
I
are
am
you
looking forward to it.
wholeheartedly in already?
Yeah. I am looking forward to it. I usually have, just for my own sake, I have low expectations just going into things, just so like
Yes.
if I am disappointed, I'm not super disappointed. I'm looking forward to it just because I also haven't seen any of the other Fantastic Four films yet. So I don't even have that as like a precursor to like of what to expect. I will probably watch those at some point. I think the biggest thing for me, this is just like overall big picture of like one, where is this going to fit in the MCU, or is it going to be in a different universe? Two, I have faith that they'll figure it out, but there's a lot of stuff happening with Kang and who knows what's going to happen there and all this other stuff, and that's kind of just like convoluted. That whole thing is just convoluted their plan as to what's going to happen. Now, the only benefit to them right now is that they're in the multiverse. Literally anyone could be Kang, so it doesn't really matter.
No.
They have the easiest out in the world. Hopefully they don't ruin it.
Have you read the I think it was a Fantastic Four annual back in the day. I think it was issue Fantastic Four annual issue 11 where Reed and Sue get married.
I have not,
You get
no.
oh if
No.
you can track that story down, it is one of the finest. It's so funny. Because it's all the villains, it's all the Marvel. You can imagine this would annual issue 11. I've got the number wrong. Anyway, it's the annual where Reed and Sue get married, and it's all the Marvel heroes of the time. So you've got Spider-Man and Daredevil, and they're all turning up at the wedding, but you've also got the villains plotting to spoil it.
There you go. Nice.
And
I
Kang,
love those, like, I love the
has
classic.
come from the future. To be
Okay.
at the wedding.
Nice. I love the classic, just like, I love the silliness of comics. And that's where I think a lot of people who watch movies sometimes, where that gets thrown in, they're like, this doesn't make sense. And like, again, if you read a comic, it doesn't, sometimes it just doesn't make sense. You just got to roll with it.
No, I mean sometimes when a couple of friends of mine who I do the hogcast with, my mate Space Lizard, he's massive on continuity. Massive. Whereas I'm not so, you would think I would be, but no, I'm not so. Or if an outfit from the comic doesn't translate well into real life and they change it, I'm not bothered.
Yeah.
But Pedro Pascal as Reed Richards, in some circles, that's a race swap. Now, for me, he's a bloke. All right, is he a little bit older? But if they lean into that dynamic, Vanessa Kirby and him being a bit older, there's a disconnect there with his ultra intelligence and her demands for a normal life. And I know this all sounds quite lame, but that's what makes it work. That's the heart. That's the heart of the storylines. And the knobhead brother, who's always out shagging birds and coming home late. And then you've got your favorite Uncle Ben. He's either your older brother or your favorite uncle. That whole thing thrown in that will be the heart of any film for quite a wide audience, actually.
It's just,
They nail it, but like I've said, I'll say again, a lot of writers and artists have tried. And I'm just looking at the Grant Morrison, Jim Lee, Mark Millar. I mean, there's Warren Ellis even done. I mean, there's writers and writers and writers here there's just tons here that have tried to make it. Obviously, the John Byrne one actually is held in high regard. Having said that, that John Byrne run in the late 80s, after we come off the X-Men.
Okay.
That's held in high regard, but that's after Lee and Kirby. But he leaned into what they were doing.
Right. I can see, like, from the context of, like, reading comments on Life Story of Fantastic Four, where they talk about that. Like, I could get that family aspect, but the writer took it in a different direction from what is pretty typical. And a lot of people, again, true Fantastic Four fans, were not very happy with the way that they took things in that kind of story, which I can understand. I still liked it. Again, this is my ignorance to other Fantastic Four comics, but I also just look at it as like a different story. That's like, this is a different, it's a different alternate universe where all of this happened, because they eventually, I'll just say they still call themselves the Fantastic Four, but like Sue's off somewhere else, Johnny's somewhere. It's just like, why are we still called the Fantastic Four?
And I think there's an element of that in this latest run, the Ryan North run.
Right.
And I don't think he's not doing a bad job. He's reinvigorating it and doing it for a modern audience, not for me. But right. And I'm not saying that they were the 10 issue that run was the 10 issues of the most crap comic I've ever read. No, it's just like, I wish you'd have got on with it a bit quicker. But starting off with them separate is good. Then get the band back together and let's go on tour. But they haven't gone on tour yet, really. I was getting a bit impatient.
I gotcha. Yeah, I think, you know, I'm looking forward to the film. I have low expectations. So I'm just going to be interested to see what the storyline is, right? Like, I like what we hashed out. Hopefully, you know, someone from Marvel listens to us and takes our, you know, Victor Von Doom helps Galactus. They defeat them and they defeat, Victor helps the Fantastic Four defeat Galactus in less than 2 hours, and we move forward.
And then they can bring in more cosmic threats after that.
I'm sure. I mean, bring in Mole Man, heck.
Yeah. You can't beat it. You can't beat it. No, you can't actually. You can't do Mole Man after Galactus.
No.
He'd have to be first, like issue one. Yeah.
Yeah.
And build up.
Well, we'll see. And from what they outlined in those comics, it seems like Galactus is going to be the main threat. The question will be, will he be the threat in the first movie, or is he going to be a looming threat moving forward?
Yeah, no, that is a good point. And I know they've cast the actor, it's the bald black guy, isn't it? He's been in plenty of things. They cast.
Oh, I didn't know that they casted someone.
Yes, unless that was some just kind like, of weird, you know, social media thing. I'll tell you who it was. It was the guy who plays Commissioner Gordon in the Batman film, the Robert Pattinson Batman film. It's him.
I don't know. I can like envision him, but I don't know. I can't think of his name right now.
But anyway, he's going to be purple.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to be
I wonder if I'm allowed to say. I wonder if the YouTube algorithm will pick this up. He's going to be purple with a big helmet.
That is true.
We'll see if the algorithm picks up and demon.
He is not Galactus. I know who you're talking about now. He's the Watcher, because he does the voice of the Watcher.
Right. No, you're right.
He does the voice of the Watcher in What If?
So that's a good bit of casting, and the Watcher, and again, I could.
It'll be interesting to see how they like make his head large. Hopefully, it looks okay.
I just hope they don't do that,
or just not do that.
Yeah, just don't.
However, it's been depicted though in like What If as like a larger head.
No,
in like the original comic. not original, but like 48, 49, 50 when he's in there. I'm like, this is weird looking.
And it can get weirder with
Sure.
certain artists in certain comics.
I mean, I like think of like kind of like what they did in the Hulk with who is that? What is that guy's name?
The Abomination.
Not Abomination. There's another
The leader.
Villain. Yes, the leader. And like how they made him look is like what I imagine. Yeah. I'm like, oh, hopefully.
Just don't do that in real life.
Yeah. It's just like, I feel like it can't look good, regardless of how great technology is.
The other one I'm thinking of is Ant-Man, Quantum Mania.
Oh, MODOK. Oh, what a mess. I mean, how can you make that look good? It's just hard to do. I mean, MODOK isn't pretty looking to begin with. Let's get real. But like,
how many levels did that go through? Like the concept, the design work, when they filmed it. If how many levels
from a like,
what was they all on? Like, is there some super skunk in LA in Hollywood at the moment where they're all on that? They're all so chilled out. They go, yeah, MODOK looks great, man.
From a silly, like slap happy sci-fi movie, it's like perfect. It's like perfect.
Slap happy. I'm gonna use that. Slap happy sci-fi. I'm like, copyrighting that.
Go for it. That's like, it like takes me back to like when I was in college, and. Yeah. When you were not doing what you're supposed to be doing in between classes, which is like studying and doing stuff, and you're sitting there watching the sci-fi channel, right? And they're just playing movies, sci-fi channel movies, which are like the very like corny, hokey sci-fi stuff. And you just see the 3D graphics and all the other stuff. And you're just like, this is terrible, but it's so bad that it's so good. It's just like,
yeah,
you can't
I'm
not.
Loving it. Yeah, that's
yeah,
it.
it's just like that's almost what I equate MODOK to. It's like, it's so bad that it just works. I don't know.
I mean, that was just because I did a review of that film. I think that was one of the last MCU films I reviewed. I went
One
to
of the dark days, one of the last dark day
videos. One of my last of my dark of the dark times, the dark era. But I can remember in the review saying, now my retinas have calmed down. The film was so bright. It was so, I don't know if you remember it, it was just all
I don't recall that, but yeah.
CGI. It was just all the brightest alien
Yeah,
planets.
I mean, that's a lot of CGI in that.
I had sore eyes when I come out. That was with Michelle Pfeiffer and
Michael Douglas.
Yeah, and they just, without knowing it, they just owned the whole film whenever they was in a scene, without even trying, because they sleepwalked through the whole thing.
Oh, I'm sure.
You could
The thing for
see.
me is just like, why are we getting, we're really going on a tangent, but I know this is what you do, so it's fine.
Yes, go off
The
those
thing for me
books.
is like, why have Bill Murray in there and his character?
Yeah.
I don't even remember his name. Same thing with like in Guardians of the Galaxy 3 with Sylvester Stallone. Like, why? 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 Just get someone else. Why pay all the money for this person who's there for less than 10 minutes?
Quirky and different.
Ooh. Is it though? It didn't even like,
is it really?
Their characters had no bearing on anything.
No.
On the whole like plot line in either movie. Like,
no.
Here's Sylvester Stallone, who, by the way, has not aged gracefully, I have to say.
No.
He has not aged gracefully. Like, you're there. You're in charge of this, you know, of shoot, I forget what they're called now. Where Michael Rooker was from, that whole side of things. You know what I'm talking about, that group.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which we haven't seen you at all in any of the other movies. So how did you get involved in this now? Like, so
Yeah, now you're
I mean,
here.
like Bill Murray, I'm like, you're just why?
Yeah, that was just pathetic, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Someone had lunch with Bill Murray one day and
Yeah,
said,
pretty much. Pretty much. You want to be in the MCU? Yeah, sure. It'll make me some money.
which would be all right. I think if everything was solid, I think if everything was as solid as a rock, a little cameo from Bill Murray and Sylvester Stallone or whoever would be a little, everyone would be going, oh, what about when so-and-so turns up? If the rest of the film was solid. But when it's the rest of the film is
Even from my perspective of someone who like generally enjoys most of the stuff that they put out, I think it's dumb. I think it like it doesn't make any sense to me. Like,
look,
why have these like big name actors come in for like less than 10 minutes of work and they have zero bearing really on the storyline? And it's like, and you're never, they both, well, Sylvester Stallone's character didn't die, but like Bill Murray's character died. Like, we're never going to see him again.
And if something appears dumb in an MCU movie, that's dumb. I mean, you know, we're not taking.
I get that it's like comic stuff and it's
we're
weird.
We're not taking
like,
mental
that's not
scores
comic
before,
stuff.
are we?
It just doesn't make any, like, to me, that doesn't make any sense. And like, I can get your perspective of like, oh, yeah, you remember when Bill Murray played so and so in Quantumania? Like, that was a good little thing for him to do.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
He didn't.
No, it was. It
he
was.
had a he had a love affair with with Michelle Pfeiffer's character, and or at least was hinted at, and that was it. And then he died. He got them caught, and then he died.
Yeah, I went, yeah. Unless he actually, I hadn't thought of that. I hadn't thought of a lot of MCU films for a long while.
I'm sorry to bring
You,
up bad.
You brought me up, Joe. Thanks for that.
I'm sorry. Now you're going to be in a deep depression for.
Yeah, I will be. Yeah, I'm
however, right. It's new comic book day tomorrow, so it'll be resolved quickly.
Yes. Yes, that will stop me from going back into Dark Hog. Return to Dark Hog days. But anyway, I think that's a good place to wrap it up, Joe. I think that's been an interesting,
sounds good,
on Fantastic Four. And I don't know whose predictions are going to come back to haunt us, probably mine. But that's the best part of what fandom's about, to be fair. You're excited. I mean, when I was back in the early days of these comics, me and my friends, bearing in mind, like I say, it wouldn't have been the early 70s, probably mid to late 70s, we would talk about, can you imagine a film, The Fantastic Four or The Incredible Hulk? Or now we're getting,
yep.
It's like, oh. No, I didn't mean that. I didn't mean that. No, but I mean, now we're getting them. Come on, yeah. Make the most of it. But, you know, we used to dream. We used to dream of this.
Right.
But
yeah.
The Fantastic Four, I think for me, they've got the writers, directors, they need to be the top of their game because they've got a big job on their hands, because in the
to
comic.
Be done right. Yeah, to be done right. And from my understanding, the little that I know again about comics, I mean, the Fantastic Four is a big lovable team that are, you know, we've got a lot of fans of.
It can be. It can be, but it can also, like I say, no one's really nailed it for 50 right. years.
Yeah.
In the source material. But that's not to say
understood.
Like, no, they can
understood.
Work
Yeah.
So yeah, until we know otherwise, we'll remain positive. What do you reckon?
Oh, I'm always on that side.
I know. That's why I'm going to keep inviting you on. You
my
can't...
young exuberance.
The yin and the yang, mate. The yin and the yang. Nice one, Joe. Thanks ever so much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
All right, mate. And best of luck with all the upcoming videos on your channel. All
Thank
the
you.
Et cetera, let's do the little businessy bit.
Yeah. How's I didn't watch your video yet, and I will. Is the Shadow of Green Goblin worth getting? Because I'm contemplating getting it tomorrow. Yeah.
Very, very good.
Okay.
Very good. It goes back to the origin, back to his, and it's a writer from
the old days.
The old days.
Demetrius, or however you say it, J.M. Demetrius.
Yeah, J.M.D. I call him.
Yeah.
And yeah, he wrote, so he wrote some of the original Green Goblin stories, the
that's pretty cool though that he's
Green
doing
Goblin Legacy or something in the '90s. Okay. I think it might have been Legacy. Anyway, doesn't matter. So, but what he's done is he's weaved the story into those early days that no one else has told.
That's cool.
Really did enjoy, because you think that you've read everything about the first, say, year of Peter Parker's life, but he's thrown another one in, and I thought, oh, this is nice. It's
that's
enough
cool.
Art school there. I'm just glad it's a mini series that, I mean, he could be put on the regular run, to be fair. They should give him Amazing Spider-Man, and he would be
I saw someone say, someone else was like, this is how you write a Spider-Man story. This is not, this has like the current Zeb Wells Amazing Spider-Man doesn't hold a candle to this issue. I was like, wow.
Yeah, all Zeb Wells is doing is he's writing the character as if it's a Dismal Minus TV script, and there, and he's like J. Jonah Jameson is silly.
That's weird.
Everything's silly. Like it's all quips. And I know, don't get me wrong, Peter Parker is quips, and it's, and because a week or two previous to that, the Spectacular Spider-Man with Miles Morales, the two of them. That is quippy, snippy all the way.
Oh, it's very quippy. Yeah.
Did you read it?
I did. Yeah, I have it.
I thought it was great. And the way that they've introduced the slice of life, you know, they go to the coffee shop 1 minute. It's a classic way of telling the story. It won't work. It will work for an issue one, maybe two.
Yeah.
But it won't work for long. So you've really got to get on with the job. But,
yeah, I'm interested to see where it goes, because it was just like a lot of that. And I'm like, well, let's see where it keeps going. Because I'm almost, after reading it, I'm like, am I going to buy another one of these? I'm not sure.
And if you enjoyed, so that is the classic, like, snippy, quippy Spider-Man. But you enjoyed Ultimate Spider-Man, didn't you?
Yeah, that's good.
That Shadow of the Green Goblin is more that tone. It's quite a serious tone.
Yep.
And there's some really, no, listen, I won't spoil it for you. There's really nice moments in there.
I just want to know if it's worth getting, because
I think so. I think that's worth
it. The shop tomorrow. So I'm like, and I couldn't go last week. So I was like, all right, well.
You better hope it's not a hot issue and it's now double the price.
No, I was like, hopefully they still have it. We'll see. Luckily, I am, surprisingly, where I live, I have like within 30 to 35 minutes of where I live, I probably have four comic book shops that I can go to.
Wow. Well, I've got my, so 30 minutes. Yeah. I've got my top two.
Yep.
But like, so the one I get my regular ones all the time, plus back issues. And then the other one is just only because I'm loyal to the main. But sometimes my main one won't have a couple of latest issues or different variants and that. So I'll still, but yeah, so there's two. Yeah, I've got three.
Okay. It's just crazy to me when I hear, like, where I live is in, it's in Maine. It's not a very populated state. It's definitely also an older population. And when I hear people don't have comic shops within hours to their house, I'm like, where do you live?
Well, that couldn't happen in England, because you go from coast to coast. I know in America,
that's
I
true.
Know it's different. I do know.
Yeah. But to me, yeah. I mean, while it is a pain to have to go somewhere else, it's, I have that opportunity if there is something that's not missing. Like Ultimate Black Panther, I went to my normal one. They didn't get their shipment, apparently, or it wasn't coming until later. I was like, what kind of operation are you running here? And then I called someone else locally, and he was like, no, we're sold out. And then I called another one who I don't normally go to, only because they're kind of like, they're still like a local comic book shop, but they've branched out and they have multiple shops in varied states across New England. And so I'm like, I'd rather support like just a one local shop owner. Yeah. But they had it. I was like, well, I guess I'm coming here because no one else has it apparently.
Yeah, so it's X-Men. What is it? Ultimate X-Men 2?
Yep. Ultimate X-Men 2. I'll be getting that one. X-Men 97 number 2 comes out tomorrow.
That's why that seems to have come around quick.
It was very quick.
I think there might be a whole new video coming, if you're up for it, on the X-Men 2 subject. What we've just done on the FF, actually.
On
I don't
Ultimate
know how
X-Men or X-Men 97?
No, in general, X-Men in
Oh,
general. I don't know
oh,
how
okay.
far back you're going, Joe, with X-Men.
That has been kind of put on hold, honestly. I've been reading more of the current stuff, and then I've just been doing Hickman's Avengers, and then I've just also been busy, and I'm just like, I haven't. There are days where I'm like, I haven't read a comic.
You're gonna tell me you've
Well,
got a wife. Next, you're gonna tell me you've got a daughter. You've got a wife. You've got a job, you know.
All those other things. No, I kind of put Krakoa down only because I've like got into like the first, what do I want to say? Main event. I don't know. It's like X of Swords. Anyway, it's like a really big event that everyone was like, you should probably read these runs that will help make sense of X of Swords. And so I got to it and I'm just like, this is too, it's almost like too big and too drawn out. I'm like, I just want to get through this now. And there's too many more issues that I got to read through. And I'm like, I don't want to have to read all these. I just want to like, let's get on with the story.
I've put on my pull list. What is it? X-Men 700? Is it issue
Oh,
700?
Yeah, 700. I would just want that for the cover.
I want to be there for the end of that.
Yeah, no, that makes sense.
X-Men, since I've got back into comics the last 3-4 years,
Yeah.
X-Men has just been impenetrable to
Oh,
like,
yeah.
it's too much.
It is. It really is.
If you want to get back into comics, if you like DC or Marvel, if you want to get back into Marvel and you think, I'm going to pick up Spider-Man, all right. I know I've commented on Amazing Spider-Man, but there's one comic to pick up. I know they do their crossovers and et cetera, et cetera. With Batman over there and Superman, there's one comic to pick up. It might be other titles and Superman. You can get World's Finest with the two of them together. But you can find a way in.
You can. You
Or
can.
the Hulk. Oh, there's one comic with a Hulk in it. Hey, Avengers.
Yeah.
Got 18 comics with X-Men. Oh, my God.
No, there's a lot. And like thinking of the new after Krakoa ends and the new ones that are coming out, it's obviously a good place to get going on for the most part for anyone new, right? But I'm like, we've got three main titles, X-Men, Uncanny X-Men, and then something else, I forget. And then we've got all the other side ones of like Phoenix. They have this NYX one. It's like the X-Men in New York City or something. I don't even know. And then something else. And I'm just like,
so they're already. I didn't know that. I didn't know they'd.
Yeah. And I'm just sitting here and I go, part of me wants to add like X-Men to the pull list, but then I'm also like, I'm gonna just wait and see what happens and wait for at least Marvel Unlimited to read them. I'll wait 3 months, but potentially and see. Because I'm like, I don't know if I want to.
I don't know.
Part of me is like, I want to read this.
Yeah, of course you do. And that is a tome.
I had to find, this is the only omnibus that I'm aware of Dr. Doom.
Wow. Is that a new one or did you have to?
It came out a few years ago, so it's out of print.
Right. Okay.
And so there's nothing out on like a normal bookseller. So it was a secondhand buy and I bought it from any ones that I found, like were from random comic book shops that had like an online store and it said it was in stock and I would buy it and all this stuff. And I get an email literally like a day later that goes, oh, we're really sorry. We don't have this. So they never like took it out of their inventory online.
Yeah.
And so then I couldn't find it except for a secondhand seller. So one was like, there's a guy who has multiple copies. He's in like Poland somewhere. And he's selling them for $150, which is not bad. But shipping from Poland is like at least $50. And I'm like, no thanks.
Shit.
So I found some guy who is in the US who bundled this. He sold this and I have it right over here. I'm just not interested in it. I'm thinking about like doing a giveaway or something like that for my channel, like once I hit 1,000. But it's the Incredible Hulk Volume 4 by Peter David Omnibus. And like I've tried to sell it online to anyone on here, just like as a secondhand market kind of thing, see if someone would buy it. I even tried to sell it to some of the comic book stores. None of them will buy it. And I'm like,
Yeah,
yeah.
David, who's the
And it's
artist?
brand new. It's still in the packaging. It's still in the packaging.
The artist on that, because Peter David was on it for ages. I thought that was a really nice run of the Hulk.
Yeah, and from my understanding, a lot of people like it.
Yeah. God.
At least on this one, at least this cover is Mike Diodato Jr.
Yeah, look at that. Yeah.
So anyway, since I can't sell it, I'm like thinking of doing it as like a giveaway. Anyway, the guy who sold me the Doctor Doom sold it with this as a bundle, and he sold it for, I want to say it was like both of them together was 150 bucks. So I was like, all right, well, this is a steal because the Doctor Doom one sells for 150. And I
Oh,
even asked him, and
right. Much
I
harder.
go, I don't want the Incredible Hulk one. I will buy the Doctor Doom one for you at like $110. Like you're making out. He's like, nah, I won't sell you just the one. I'm like, dude, I don't want this Incredible Hulk one. I will pay you more money than what you're getting basically for the Doctor Doom one when you just split it evenly. He's like, nah. I'm like, well, I guess I'm buying this Incredible Hulk omnibus that I don't want.
You know those comic shops local to you, that do they not want to trade it in for some comics?
I asked, so the one that I was going to normally, but now I don't work in that direction. I work somewhere else in the
Yeah.
state. So the one that I go to now, I haven't asked them. I should ask them.
You just say, look, I've got
But the
this.
one that I asked originally where I was going, and they were like, we already have a couple of volumes, not of this, but of other, like in this one, like volume one or two. And he's like, we haven't moved them, so I don't want to buy it. And I was like, all right, I respect that. And then the one who I will never step into this guy's comic shop ever, just because I had a bad conversation with him via email. I was like, hey, I saw that you buy stuff online and would you, I have this brand new, would you be willing to buy it? He goes, if we wanted that, we would just get it from our like seller. Our and I was like, why are you an asshole about it? You could just say no. No, we don't need it.
Thank
That's all
you.
you had to say. That's literally all you had to say. He was like, no, if we wanted that, we would get it from our seller. I go,
Could say that this item is still available from our wholesalers. Or what I
yeah.
would have said when I still had the shops is I would have said, well, I can get that from the wholesaler at $100. I'll bet that book, if they're selling it for $150,
Yeah, I don't know what they're selling it for,
the
but
cheapest, but say that's retail, $150.
yeah.
The cheapest a shop is going to be able to buy that for is because there's no more.
It's 125
Right,
retail.
125. So if you assume that the biggest markup is 30, 33%, like a third profit, they've got to pay, say, $90 for that book, $85.
I am willing,
I'd say
like
to
I
you,
was willing to give it for like 60 bucks.
Down. Yeah, do you want to bring it down to 50, 60?
Yeah. That's
60.
honestly what I was looking to get 60 bucks. Like all I wanted to get was like bring down the Doctor Doom that I bought it for like 200 bucks.
The other angle, and the other angle on it is trading it in for back issues. Not
Hmm.
new, not brand new, because and I've only got my shop hat on
I
now.
gotcha. No, I appreciate
Brand new,
that.
because the brand new stuff you need to earn. You need to earn your profit on them, and it
Sure.
isn't a lot. It really isn't a lot on new
I'm
books.
sure it's not, which is why.
Back issues, if someone's bringing you in that big book, you think, all right, it might sit on the shelf, but I can offer that for sale. I'll probably eBay it, Joe. Just eBay it.
Yeah. Well, anyway, I was just like, after that one email, and I never had gone into this guy's shop, and he was like, if we wanted that, we could just get it from our wholesaler. And I go, you're an asshole for saying it like that.
Yeah.
I've never setting foot inside of your
You're
shop.
voting with your feet and you're not going in there anymore.
No. So,
Well.
anyway, but yeah, I'm like, re so I think my hard thing is like, I'm reading this and I want to make videos about it. I think the hard part is like, most of the stuff I'm trying to read now is like older. So it's not like trendy per se, right? It's not with what's current. Not that that matters per se. So I'm
No.
like, what is my angle that I can put on it to make it worthwhile someone to watch on YouTube? Because no one,
I
people
would.
may not care about reading the first official Fantastic Four.
Where we're at, no, but where we're at, I don't think that comes into it just yet. I think it's what you enjoy doing a video of, like, if you're really, really into Doctor Doom, I would do that. I would say and tell people how much you're enjoying it, because I've done a Conan video. I'm a Conan fan all my life, like, since the first film with Arnie, and I've been getting the comics before that. I've done a comic recently on the new magazine, Bad Printing, and I compared it to issue one from 1970. I think it was exactly 40 years ago, right? That the issue one come out. It was 40 years. And that got so much good traction. You know, I'm not talking 100,000 views, I'm talking, I think it's on about 1,300 at the moment, but it gets views every day.
Yeah,
It
that's what you want.
yeah. And it gets, and when you look at your little analytics behind the scene, not that I'm fussed about that, but my point is that I enjoyed doing it. I didn't do it because I thought, oh, Conan's hot at the moment.
I gotcha.
Do what you enjoy.
Yeah.
Because I can
Not.
tell, like, your videos, and you enjoy them all, don't get me wrong. I know you're not
Oh,
doing
yeah.
any of them in a cynical format. But yeah, so carry on doing that. And if you think, I'm going to do a Doctor, and then you look forward to doing it, and you plan it, and then you think, I'm going to do a Doctor Doom one. I'm going to waffle on about this, and I'm going to drop the pictures in, and I'm going to, then you end up gushing. I mean, some of the ones I've done, Joe, like for hour and a half, 2 hours, gushing about Judge Dredd and Brian Bolland's artwork or whatever it is. Do it. And there are other geeks out there.
That's true. That's true.
Brilliant. Like us too. Come on. We've waffled, but we've not waffled long enough.
Oh, well, I mean, we could probably keep waffling, but
I think so. I think, and you'd see the sunset, my side.
yeah.
You'd see the sun right now. We're opposite end of the planet. Like, perhaps we'll do a 24-hour-a-thon for charity.
There we go. We just gotta.
Oh,
Yeah,
brilliant.
I don't know.
Brilliant. Anyway, I'll catch up with you on Fred's sunshine.
Yep, sounds good.
As always, and probably next month at the end of, where are we now? April. Yeah. Catch up with a review or two. And when does Doom drop, issue one, that comic?
That's in May.
Right.
May. I want to say it's the beginning of May, like May 6th or maybe whatever that first Monday, whatever that first Wednesday is, I think.
We'll catch up.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Still so upset that that's only a one shot. I'm like,
Oh,
yeah. Anyway.
mate. Thanks, Joe, as
Yep.
always.
No, thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, until next time. I'm going to do an adios because I didn't do a bon. You didn't allow me to do a bonjour. We just went straight in.
We did just go right into
Just went into pure waffle.
it.
Adios, Joe.
Adios.